The infamous Redline Stealer malware has been found being distributed by the official Microsoft repo on GitHub. But how? It's not exactly what you think. It's actually pretty interesting and something you definitely need to know about. If you haven't heard of the Redline Stealer type malware, it basically, like the name suggests, is designed to steal a bunch of info after it infects you. Mostly it's going to be looking for crypto wallets, but also cookies from your browser. That's how a lot of YouTubers get hacked. They kind of steal the session cookies and then it can already be logged in. It bypasses security methods. And also they're going to be looking for autofill for passwords and stuff like that. Really anything they can get their hands on. So it's nasty stuff. So then how was this malware seemingly able to be linked via the GitHub repo officially from Microsoft, the VC package one? And actually, it's not as hard as you think. Literally anyone can do it. You see, how GitHub works is you can attach files and stuff and upload them to posts that you're making, and you can simply do that by dragging a file into the comment box, and it will upload it to the content distribution network, give you a link that you can include in that post. But there's two notable things about this that the malware can take advantage of. First is that the link that it creates has the same URL as the repo that you're uploading it to. So you can make it kind of look like it's from any repo you want. And the link and the file uploaded stays working even if you don't end up making the post. Simply dragging the file into it and it stays there, and then you can use that link wherever you want, even if you don't actually make the post. So you can see here, I uploaded an example text file to the same repo that the malware creators were using, the VC package one, and it has the format where it's just github.com/the account name, the repo, and then files, a random file number, and then it also keeps the original file name. So you can see how you might be able to trick people into thinking, oh, well, this is just a file hosted by Microsoft because it's from their official repo with their link and everything. Now, not every file type can be uploaded directly into like a comment box. There is a list of possible ones, but one of them is a zip file. So effectively you can put whatever you want into that and it's the same thing. And yes, the links basically stay active as far as I know indefinitely, unless someone detects that it's malware, then they manually go and take it down. Now, I did notice if you upload an image file like this GIF, it's a little bit different. So in that case, the format is the account name and then the repo, and then it says assets, a random long number, and then a random long string. It doesn't show any file extension because this right here is like a short code for markup. But if you do go into the preview and get the direct link to the image, it's even more odd looking. It's privateuserimages.githubusercontent.com/a bunch of random letters and numbers, and then the file extension, but it doesn't even keep the original file name. I think that probably makes a lot more sense to have if you're uploading to a repo that maybe isn't your own. So at least people can kind of get an idea that, all right, this looks a bit suspicious. Yeah, if someone's posting it as a comment to that repo, they're expecting it to be for that. But if someone just sends it to you on, like, I don't know, a chat app, that's gonna be raising red flags. But again, it only does that really long, weird URL if it's an image file, not for other file types, apparently. However, in this case, beyond the URL that they use, the way that the malware spreads between users is actually very interesting. Before I get into the details though, something else that's being spread around online is your personal data, which is where today's sponsor comes in, Aura. Sketchy data brokers out there collect and sell your information to scammers, spammers, and anyone else who may want to target you. I'm talking your full name, email, home address, health records, your relatives, it's all out there. But that's where Aura comes in. For example, it can show me which data brokers are selling my info and automatically submit opt-out requests for me. Cleaning up this info not only helps me reduce the amount of spam coming my way, but also protects me from hackers who might leverage this info to try and access my accounts or even do personalized phishing attacks. I was even surprised when it showed me that the collected public info out there even included what kind of car I drive. But Aura also has a ton of other features such as an antivirus, VPN, password management, parental controls, identity theft insurance, all in one place instead of needing a bunch of separate apps. Even if you already have one or two of these tools, you could be leaving doors open to bad actors. But Aura is always on, so you can have peace of mind and focus on the important stuff. To get started, you can go to aura.com/theojo to start your 2-week free trial. Link is also in the description. And with all that being said, let's continue. All right, like I said, the way this malware spreads is pretty interesting beyond just the URL that they're using. And that is because it actually uses like a referral system. When you go and run the installer, it's for like a cheating software. So honestly, I don't have the biggest sympathy for people trying to download cheats if they get infected. That's their problem. But what's interesting is if you run the program, it pops up a thing and basically says that the software you're running is like a demo, but you can get a full licensed free copy if you refer a friend, and it even gives like a license code that you type in, and I guess it claims it'll automatically detect it. I assume it's going to be the same code that everyone gets, and it's just a lie, obviously, but it's kind of funny that it tries to get you to send the malware to your friends, which probably is very effective because, you know, people are more trusting if a friend sends it to them and they know, okay, it's not this person's hacked, they're actually sending it to me, as opposed to just a random link. Even beyond all that, though, it is actually pretty interesting and clever how they hide the payload of this malware and how it avoids detection, at least until the point where you run it. And that's because the actual malicious payload that ends up installing all the bad stuff on your computer is in the form of something called bytecode. Specifically bytecode for a scripting language called LUA, but let me explain bytecode first for a second. You're probably already familiar with the term like source code and possibly even machine code. Source code is the code that a human actually writes. It's got like words and stuff in it. And then the machine code is what the source code gets compiled into. And the machine code is literally like the CPU instructions, like copy this data into this memory address, that sort of thing. It's not human readable if you looked at it. Bytecode is sort of like machine code, except instead of running directly on the hardware, like the physical CPU, it actually runs on software. Like you might have heard of Java, not JavaScript, but regular Java. For example, Minecraft uses that. And in the past, this isn't too common anymore, but what you would do is if you wanted to run a Java application, like a .jar file, assuming it wasn't bundled with the program like it is with Minecraft, you would have to have the Java software installed. The Java runtime environment was called. Otherwise, if you tried to run the jar file, the computer wouldn't know what to do with it. It's not native machine code. It's specifically for the Java. And then Java has its own virtual machine that runs the code. Not like a big whole virtual machine like you download and then run Windows on its whole separate operating system. It's like a very small virtual machine specifically just for running Java files, but same idea. And so the bytecode, instead of having machine code that has CPU instructions, it has Java instructions on it. But the bytecode still is not human readable. There still is source code for Java files. It's just the source code then gets compiled into bytecode instead of machine code, and then it runs on the virtual machine. Another example is Python. You might know that. To run a Python application, you have to have Python installed, otherwise it won't work. Sometimes there's ways where you can kind of bundle it all together, but I'm talking about in general. And again, like the other stuff, you write actual Python source code as a human, and then when you go to actually run the Python code, it does indeed compile into bytecode first. It just happens very fast. That's kind of the whole point of these bytecode software, is you don't have to spend like a whole bunch of time compiling a big, huge program in a native machine code. It's very fast. And then you'll actually see, if you run a Python program, the PyCache folder with PyC files in there, that's the compiled bytecode. Anyway, going back to the main topic of the video, LUA, which is the type of bytecode that this malware comes with, is the same idea. It's sort of like its own scripting platform type thing, and it's very lightweight. So instead of Python and even Java, which is kind of like heavy, you have to do a whole installation, it's kind of a pain. LUA, I guess from my understanding, it's can be very small, like a single executable, which is what this is. It's like two files, and then the readme file is a text file. But if you actually open it up, the malware is in there as bytecode, so you can't actually read it. It's not a real readme text file. Also, I guess bytecode is probably a little bit harder for antivirus to scan. It's not like machine code, so it would have to rely on the behavior of the application. Although, for the most part, that's what every antivirus has to do anyway. Malware is really good at obfuscating itself, so they just kind of see what it's doing as opposed to what the malware code is. So I think really the bytecode aspect of it is more for just initial detection before it gets ran. But even after the malware gets downloaded and ran, it still does have a couple more tricks up its sleeve. So one way it runs automatically on startup and persists is it actually creates scheduled tasks in the Windows task scheduler, which is something I've seen a lot. There's actually some malware that runs fully, purely off scheduled tasks. It's called fileless malware. So it's possible to have malware that doesn't even use files. It literally just runs purely off the code in that scheduled task. But apparently in this case, the malware also creates like a fallback in the form of files in a random program data directory. So it can kind of rely on that if someone deletes the schedule task or something. So yeah, these days you can't even rely on text files being safe. Although again, it's not like you run the text file and it executes, it's the other programs, which is usually what you'd be watching out for, but still, you gotta know. And of course, be aware that it is possible for anyone to make a URL on GitHub that looks like it's from any repo they want. So don't trust that, just know that that's possible and you should be pretty well protected to just not trust anything, just treat it like any other random link. So let me know what you think down in the comments. Were you aware that this could be done on GitHub? And now you'll know to look out for it. Thanks again to Aura for sponsoring this video. If you want to protect your data and take advantage of all the other features it has, go to aura.com/theojo for a 2-week free trial, link in the description. If you enjoyed the video, be sure to give it a big giant thumbs up for the YouTube algorithm. And if you want to keep watching, the next video I recommend is where I talk about a meme that I created that saved hundreds of people from wasting their monitor's potential. It's kind of funny. I'll put that link right there you can click on. So thanks so much for watching and I'll see you in the next one.